again, in 15 minutes, right between the two sessions, so that we can allow people who haven't been there to come over. It's a pleasure that with Megan, the Egyptian Scientific Society of Oncology, which is held in Cairo. Actually, it's a very good chance for the pediatricians to share in a whole session this collaboration with the adult chest diseases is actually mandatory because our babies will eventually grow and they might have the diseases with them, and so we have to have a close link. We'll start by presenting the chairpersons. We have Professor Dr. Sonia Wiss. She's a professor of pediatrics and communicable diseases, director of the Cystic Fibrosis Center, University of Michigan. We have Dr. Mona Farahi, professor of pediatrics, Cairo University, Allergy and Immunology. We have Dr. Nadia Mustafa, professor of pediatrics and Allergy and Immunology. And me, I am the head of the pediatric department and immunology. The first speaker will be our dear guest. She's been here repeatedly, and she's one of the team, she's one of us, and we are very happy to have you around. Representing Professor Dr. Sonia Wiss, MD, the Professor of Pediatrics and Communicable Diseases, the Director of the Cystic Fibrosis Center, University.
Thank you very much for inviting me. It's always a great pleasure for me to come here. Just a moment, I've been in Italy and here we are. Thank you again. Today I'm going to talk about vertebral dysplasia. The UPD serves women diagnosed with discovered or identified in the 60s. And since then, there is a new UPD, if you will, because of the change in the nature of the neurodiversity. The definition of BPD is alterations in the vertebral structure and function due to hyperacid exposure and mechanical ventilation in the context of lung development. So we have very young preemies, and the preemies have to be intubated or have to be ventilated. They are hyperacid. So the good news is we try to save the lungs and the living longer and they're doing better, but the cause of what we're doing to help them get better is preventable of the disease. So that's part of that picture. I'm going to cover today the lung development just briefly. Classic BPD versus new BPD, pathogenesis, the role of infant PFT, and that would be just very much in the passing because there's not an experience to that. Long-term prognosis and treatment. As you probably all know, there's the stage of the lung development, you have the embryonal phase, the supraglandular phase, the follicular phase, sexual, and alveolar. And it depends on when the baby is born, then you're having the development of the prematurity of the lungs. The rest of the babies are born 25 weeks and above is going to be a viable baby. So that's when the prematurity stage. This is just to show you the stages. At your 4 weeks, you have the JT developed, the bronchial starts to develop, the embryonal phase, the supraglandular phase, and this is at around 6 around and realize when the next group is going to be together. That's the key thing. So now we're going to talk about the classic VQG versus new VQG. The classic VQG was initially described by Dr. Northway in 1967. He's a geologist, and he was in Stanford, and he was looking at a lot of X-rays, and X-rays are showing different characteristics. And then he would show the X-rays from a baby that's born to a baby that's older, and he looked at the changes in the X-ray. And that's when they were able to, he was able to destroy the disease and kill both of them. The disease is characterized by airway injury, with airway epithelial metaplasia, increased smooth muscle mass, and fibrosis. Non-uniform inflammation of the lungs with combination of emphysema and fibrosis. And that's important, because that point is changed in the new BPD. That is not a non-uniform, it's not a biuniform BPD. Most reduction of neural development and organic inflammation as well. That's why we use a lot of steroids in health care to protect. And this is again a picture of a family of seven. They all, you can see there, the lot of the red out, if you will, and then some of the inflammation. And it progressed to become more of a, you know, cystic changes or hyperinflammation, and that's when the disease is more established. So the new BPD, we're doing a lot of things that I know you people are very much involved with this here too, about where the success and the Thank you. patient, I need to know what's the cause of the problem. If I know that inflammation is the cause of the problem, then I'm going to use anti-inflammatory medication in this case. So that's very important to know the same thing with other diseases as well. During the first days of postnatal loss, an influx of putting macronutrients and macrophages in the tracheal aspect. So we get a lot of blood pressure from these patients, especially the mechanical of the ventilator wound. And then the more you find putting macronutrients and macrophages in the tracheal aspect, the more they are developed. The more there is inflammation going on, the more they are developed with the aspect of wound. Cytokines are very important factors as well. That's an indication of inflammation. And this way, just to show that this is, once you have the ventilator trauma, you have hyperoxia, and hypoxia, you already stimulated inflammatory markers, you stimulated cytokines, and the anti-inflammatory markers are trying, but usually this field is tipped over more. That's in addition to immature wound, it's inflammation, then it ends up with the BPD, and then the process of resolution and repair. Nutrition service is also very important for these patients to have their wounds as well. We use a lot of intracranial tension from testing in our center and other centers as well. It's something that's been increased use. And what we're doing is we're doing our studies doing the babies, shortly after they're stabilized and also going to them, and then periodically they're also. We do it every 3 months or every 6 months. It shows us by status components in the lung, the therapeutic activity, but your different medication, we'll see which one they're responding to more. They've been a very important tool for us. George Mallory reported in 1991, which was very early for infant PFTs, they had a serial maximum respiratory flow volume over the first 3 years of life in these patients, and the level to severe patients that they found that the working capacity of the time to lower. You have severe lower airway obstruction persisting. Lewis is another researcher that was working in infant PFTs very early on. I remember meeting him in one of the meetings, and there was a lot of debate about the standards for infant PFTs. He measured the lung compliance and conductance and the FOC by nitrogen ratio over the first 3 years of life. And so meeting the BCG criteria, the last criteria that was found in the test. Both parameters were decreased in the first 6 months of life, but conductance and FOC reached near normal by 3 years of life. And Ray Pippler is another researcher, also the one of the ones that developed the infant PFTs from Indianapolis, and he's been very, very involved in studying these patients, and he also reported that pressure force respiratory flow and functional residual capacity by hearing dilution in infants with BPD less than 10 months of age, post-conception, both of these parameters are significantly decreased. There's LVRTC technique, which is a newer technique for infant PFTs, which also has been used, and now we're using more of this technique to the infant PFTs. And there's a lot of research that's going on with using this process. This one just shows you the difference. This is normal, and this is just with BPD. And you can see it looks like asthma patients. There's this poop being filled, there's obstructive components, so that's very important to know. And we most of the time treat them like asthma patients. For the long-term process, relative to MAT control, those with history of BPD, they also have lower height and weight. And these are babies that started to be identified in the early 80s and early 60s and 70s. The focus on nutrition wasn't as much as it is right now. Right now, we're focusing so much on nutrition, most of them are okay on nutrition. They have lower height and weight, these are the adults that have airway obstruction, lower FAV1 and FAV2475. Most of them have air trapping, elevated ORV to TLC ratio, and greater incidence of airway upper respiratory symptoms. And that was in a follow-up study from Norway's group in Stanford. And the abnormal upper respiratory symptoms and diffusion capacity have been known. job. He came in, this is his exam. He's at the New York State, and the wife saw this all for somebody. He was leaving on first exploration. You can see, when we get the lymph function, you can see that all his brain cells are blue, except for the ALV for something, this is what he gives here with the blue, which is decision to be seen. And this is his X-ray, and you can see that there is a restriction in his airways here, and there is homogeneity in the CT scan. So what's the treatment of BPD? So we know we have babies with BPD and we need to treat them. And the treatment really evolves through the years, like I said before. We used to not really focus so much on the weight. And now we're focusing so much on making sure that we can carry the weight, compare them to test normal, so that I compare to control. And we've been doing much better in the treatment with at least supplements and at least oral intake. Supplemental oxygen. We do supplemental oxygen at birth, which we work with organ methodology colleagues, and it's kind of a back and forth issue. The residents in our hospital are trained in the material. We have oxygen. When they go to the floor, they don't wean the oxygen of the baby's remaining life. They don't wean the oxygen of the baby's respiratory status of their stable. So it's a different ballgame that we usually try to teach them. We use bronchodilator, beta agonist, and anticholinergic, depending on the airways. We do a lot of bronchoscopy on them, and about 20% of them have major airway abnormalities, circulation, bronchodilation. In this situation, you're going to need anticholinergic. So I can't treat them to start with this bronchodilator, but it's not my aspirin, and you really need to do the bronchoscopy to evaluate. And we have steroids as well, really our bottom bottle of this population. We use a lot of it, and it's been very, very helpful. And we try to make it even well according to the chairs for sports and diabetes for sports. And again, nutrition. I'm a pulmonologist, but sometimes when I'm talking to patients, you think I'm a GI or a nutritionist, because I see the storage of calories of these patients that they do well. A lot of them have GI reflux. And that's also sclerosis for asthma patients, the cystic fibrosis patient. Because of the magnitude of the piercing and the stress ahead, they have to pay attention to it and treat it as well. Biologics, most of them, they come to us from the NICU and biologics, and gradually we wean them off of it. But they still don't need it for longer than others. And the immunization, we focus on all the babies, catch up with the immunization and then also the influenza. But the flu immunization, we give it to them every year. And we monitor them very closely to make sure that they don't get them. So in conclusion, there appears to be a phenotypic correlation in some infants with BPD from that of classic airflow obstruction and mild artificial abnormal development. The biological mechanisms are multifunctional, locally in fluid form from time, environmental, genetics, as the family has done some history of asthma, you're probably going to have stronger presentation in PD. The biological mechanism or multifactorial locking or exit. Lung function outcome is not significantly worse than in the past. Despite outcome being born earlier, we're serving babies earlier in life, so the long-term effect is very similar, which is good for us. There continues to be a significant group with bronchodilator responsiveness and may benefit from inhaled gas. Long-term prognosis is with newer, milder form of airway disease remains to be seen, because we don't know what they're going to do as they get older. We know that BPD patients, as they get older, the risk of our 6 years, 10 years now, they're still having asthma problems. So what we do is we start to follow them up now and see if they get older, and if we get smarter and treating them, we'll see what they're going to do. This is the end of the book. Thank you very much.
Would you like to introduce yourself, please?
Professor Dr. Bernardo Castillo, Professor Dr. Bernardo Castillo, Professor Dr. Bernardo many thanks for this nice and comprehensive presentation for Dr. Bernardo Castillo. My question for the citizen is the prevalence of major global pollution and the care for the nation in cases of the impact of the discussion that we've seen in the approaches. I think that
Yeah, that's a good point.
well, so this is really the flu only. But if I have a baby, I'm saturating anti-active sounds regularly, not blowing out any of the oxygen. But I'm more conscious of not just giving them oxygen, sending them home, because of all the issues you don't want to give it to them. But oxygen in the older age group is a medicine. It is the best medicine to use if the kids are not blowing out and if they need it. We wean them, we see them better free from the zoom of their lungs. So make sure to wean them down and get an oxygen tank, get them off oxygen. But that, you know, the fear of using oxygen in all the children is not the same as using it in any other and we've been very successful in that. And what I think that, as you're alluding to, is that we've been accepting lower oxygen saturations. We used to say 94%, 95%. And if you look at the oxygen saturation curve, it doesn't even make too much of a difference. So we say 90 and above is okay. So we do use the oxygen monitoring to make sure we're doing the right thing. But, you know, oxygen is not something to be feared of, because in the older age group, you really just focus on the strength of the lung development, which is not going to happen if you're not growing, and then also to get them to be doing
the right. The other person is so frequent in the body, what if they don't think they have kids as well, in these cases, if you can also sometimes more than that. But so frequent in the people who are not with the disease, especially in the kids, that are absent from them. But they do it frequently, or what's their kids?
We don't do it routinely, the person of empathy, we do not do it routinely in these patients unless there is some indication for it. Most of the BCG patients follow the picture of you know, the textbook picture. So if somebody is not really following the process that we think they should be following, then we will want to do it. But it's not highly used, it's used as indicator. But what's highly used is the interpretive team. And then the frequent visits to make sure that we're interpreting.
When a children are being a manipulatist, it's a very, really interesting topic. And we do see a lot of these babies, and actually, I mean, maybe systematic about the topic. I was just going to ask for the introduction of the subject. Was the pulmonary hemorrhage and intracranial hemorrhage increased? Because we noticed that there is a marked increase in the pulmonary hemorrhage and intracranial hemorrhage for the usage of surfactant in young babies, especially when the more, let's say, the less weakest they are and the less weight they are. Very uncomfortable.
I was very involved in the very early process of developing surfactant. I wasn't doing the research myself, but I was very involved in very interested in something new and yes, you know, I was trying the children in Detroit and then moved down to University of Michigan and they really were very closely involved with this process. There was probably hemorrhage at the beginning, there was some increase of it, and that's why it took a little longer to start using it. But for more information, it's not an ongoing, it's much safer to use. And they developed the protocol, they did, so it's a lot safer to use right now.
Is it buzz related? Is it buzz-related?
Buzz-related and also product-related. And I think there are new products in the market where it's safer to use. And also buzz-related and when to give it. When to give it and how much to give. And they have a protocol and a new center of how to do it and when to do it. And everybody's trying to do it very quickly.
And actually, now it's even used during resuscitation in the delivery room. Cases for prevention, even especially if you were going to deal with a very tiny preemie. So, is it safe to use them as long as we are going to use them for prophylaxis before the occurrence of the preemie, especially in the delivery room?
But my understanding is that it has been used for prophylaxis because you know the baby is a preemie and you know that it will occur. The lung is premature, so understood that. I mean, you know, some of them will need more ventilatory support than others, but we keep it, but
yes.
Need anything other than just oxygen. It also depends on the prenatal care. If the mom comes in delivering at 32 weeks and she has good prenatal care, what are we going to check? If they come in sometimes at 36 weeks and if they haven't seen a situation, then it's going to be really bad. So I think prophylaxis is very important, and there are two
groups of people. something else that you can learn. The treatment of the BPD that you've been studying, actually we're using all the criteria except the multiple writers. I just wanted to know, when should we start the multiple writers, the blockers, the little blockers, at what stage?
So what we usually do is, when the neurotherapist is finished, we have finished playing with the baby, we get them. And then we start looking at the baby. The baby is not growing well, we focus on that. The baby is delayed immunization, we give them the immunization. And then we look at the baby's tachypnea, because a lot of them are not really aware of that. They lost the tachypnea. So that tachypnea, and the embryo give them first orthodontism to see if that will help them. It's a bath in moving to inhaled steroids. I really don't like to use orthodontism routinely, except in cystic fibrosis. I do use it routinely twice a day. So in the BPD patient, if the orthodontism is going to help them, then I'm going to use inhaled steroids. And then we move on from there, and then sometimes they still have to keep them without the reflex. So we either work them up to reflex or just treat them. This is our GRF release and incisions. If you think it has, just treat it. So we usually treat that too. And like I said, we see them. I usually see patients, asthma patients, every 6 months in my clinic, cystic fibrosis patients every 3 months. These kids I see every month at the beginning to make sure we're not missing anything. And we're trying very hard to be in oxygen. We send them with them, like an overnight oxygen saturation monitoring. And we put them in the air and teach the patient what to do. Really, it's certain protocols you have to be followed for this, but they're doing much better than that.
And we're just not applying the real oxygen. Anyway, I guess if we're going to start talking about the media, I don't think we'll be able to finish the whole session. Thank you very much.
It's a little bit of a talk. I'm going to introduce you. So Dr. Mona Arifaliki, as you know her very well, she's a professor of pediatrics. She's a lot of energy and pulmonary function now. So, this is a good thing, sorry. She's been actually a Bengali. Get more visual faculty involved in learning, and we're very happy to work with them and been publishing. As faculty members, junior faculty members here, it's been very, very nice working with her and thrilled to continue with this collaboration.
I guess one of the above the time, like you just said to say. One? You want to buy the time, like you just said to say? Diseases of the lungs and the airways are a major cause of morbidity and mortality in infants and young children, and dominating all airways and illnesses that have been increasing tremendously in prevalence over the last 3 to 4 decades, so that almost 30 to 40% of children will experience at least one major episode in the first 2 years of life. So we are speaking about 1/3 of the pediatric population in this young age. And if you look to this young boy, this is a picture of a patient we all see now predominating in emergency rooms in all pediatric hospitals. This child is is about 7 to 8 months as an age, is taking them to live through an early childhood. Not only is the prevalence rate increasing, but the incidence rate is very high, very early in life, as shown in this study of cosmetic patients. The incidence is high very early in life, in the first year of life, compared to later on in older children and adults, and in no other age group, as we see, there is the prevalence of facing is too high as in the first 2 years of life. Again, the prevalence of viral-induced phasing is also age-dependent, and it is highest, as we see here, in patients less than 6 months of age, reaching about 96%. It is still high till the age of 2 years, and then it is reducing gradually. So, infancy is a period where there is increased prevalence and incidence of early life phasing. Is it possible that these old children have a disease affecting their airways? Why are these children uniquely susceptible or extensively susceptible to airway obstruction? Is it possible that all these children have diseased airway? Or is early life phasing just a peculiar response and temporary response of their developing and vulnerable airway to the changing environment? Throughout this talk, I will try at least partially to answer these very difficult questions. The epidemiological data I have shown you and the lack of longitudinal studies have greatly emphasized the possible role of perinatal, prenatal, and early postnatal events acting on the developing lung and airways and predisposing them to being increasingly susceptible to airway obstruction. These factors or events may be inherent related to the fetus itself, genetic factors, gender, and affinity. May be related to the environment of pregnancy, the uterus, physical factors interfering with the fetal respiratory movement or with the growth of the lungs, or may be related to pregnancy, for example, prematurity, or related to the mother when exposed to environmental air pollution, exposure to tobacco smoke, the process of resuscitation and treatment itself of a preterm child, as we have heard very nicely from Dr. Sanlakan, add to the injury of the airways, infections during pregnancy, and possibly many other still unidentified factors. And these factors act together, more than one factor may act together, air pollution with prematurity or infection and so on. So it is very difficult to study each alone. This factors affect the qualities and quantity of the developing lung and airways and are referred to as programmers. They act in the periods of crucial and sensitive periods of fetal or early postnatal life development and can have lifelong outcome, and therefore they are called programmers, and this whole process is called programming. The child is programmed during his fetal development to continue on having problems later on, even in later life. So that children happen already in part growth during the intrauterine life and the first 3 years of life will fail to attain the expected growth of lung structure and function and can have exaggerated decline, the normal decline which is expected with age will be exaggerated in these children, and added insults were even lead to further accelerated decline and early appearance of respiratory symptoms. Now, factors acting on the developing lung and airways early during gestation will affect mainly the airways. Later in gestation, these factors will affect the alveoli, but the airways will be affected as well. I will not go into the details of this figure because it has been very nicely explained by Dr. Sanya. Now, these factors can result in insults to the airway, and as in every tissue, insults are usually followed by the pain. However, in some of these children, their pain may follow an abnormal or apparent course and result in an apparent repair, with quantitative changes in the airway compartments. the amount of cartilage may increase or decrease, the amount of source muscles, and so on. The whole structures can be changed, changes in the biochemical composition, material properties of the various constituents of the airways, resulting in structural architecture and changes in the mechanical properties of the airways, leading to functional derangement and making those children uniquely susceptible to airway obstruction because of the reversible component of airway obstruction or increase in airway related skin surface, as we see in asthmatic patients. Now, this is a developing young, at the age of collecting senior. Very early during gestation, we see how well developed are the airways. We have the finger-like processes, branching to make the bronchial tree, surrounded with this greenish color, the mesenchyme, which will lay on this epithelial branching airways, the smooth muscles, the nerves, and all the other structures of the airways. And this mesenchyme acts also as a scaffolding system, a supporting system, basically supporting this branching pericline airways. The red is the actin of the smooth muscles, as we see here at the periphery, completely encircling the airways and here in a pulmonary blood vessel. So even at this young stage, the lungs are very well developed. We see here the nerves reaching to the periphery and here are the branching airways. We see at 16 week gestation how well developed are the airways. There are circular smooth muscles, the nerves, the ganglia, and this nerve is going into the muscles that lie in them. There is parasympathetic receptors. So these children are born with a fully developed airway that can constrict and they can manifest asthma very early in life for a very reason, secondary viral infection. Because there is a common belief that asthma can be before 2 years of age, and this is where we can asthma can start very early, and there is all of the structures needed are all present. Not only structurally are the airways developed extensively as well, but if you look at this, here the airways are dilated, and in response to mechanical stimulation, there is narrowing of the airways. Here, in response to metacholine, there is a narrowing of the airways, and when atropine was put to the media, there is dilatation of the airway again, so the airways are developed structurally and functionally. Infants are not miniature airways. This is very important. Although they are born with a whole set of airways as adults, there is a lot of anatomical and physiological differences between the respiratory system of infants and that of older children and adults that makes them uniquely susceptible to airway infection. And these differences are only part of the normal natural developmental process. These are not disease conditions. These children have highly compliant control. They have airways with a small absolute diameter with increased compliance. They can show flow limitation. They have increased in the source, the amount of source muscles in relation to the airway size. The shape of the top section of the airway may play a role. They have an amount of mucous glands that is increased in relation to the airway size. They have stiff lungs with low compliance, decreased collateral and dual ventilation, and then weak cough. And as I said, this is only part of the transition from the neonatal period to later on. As they grow, we see there is decrease in resistance by about 40% in the first year of the respiratory resistance, and there is increase in compliance by 150% in the first year of life, mainly due to increased compliance of the lung. So there is improvement in lung function with increasing age, and as the child grows, we know that the airway resistance is getting to the 1 over the radius raised to the power of 5. So a 2 millimeter increase in the size of the ramp of the airway can result in marked drop in the resistance of the airways. Now I am going to more details of the different airway factors, environmental factors, and factors related to pregnancy, causing increased predisposition to airway obstruction. If you look at this picture, the sex and the facility of the child definitely has a role. This boy is at an increased risk of becoming wheezy than this black boy. The circles represent the red color is the boys, and the blue color is the boys, and we see that
that those and all of us at the lower level were considering maximum hysterectomy for 25% of the successive vital capacity in relation to the length of the tree. The boys are always at the above level and the boys at the lower level. So boy, a boy, they have smaller airways and larger lungs, so they are at the increased risk of recurrent reason, and not only recurrent reason, respiratory distress syndrome, bronchial nerve dysplasia, all of these conditions are more in boys than girls. And we see that at the incidence of facility and sex, we see here resistance, airway resistance, the respiratory resistance, and black female are the least risk. And the highest risk are for the white man. And the table present index as well, it is best in the black female and worst in the white man. What about different environmental exposures? And I will start with exposure to tobacco smoke, because this is something we can prevent. And it has great impact on the children, as you see this mother. Surely she was here, she was smoking during pregnancy. And children born to mothers smoking pot during pregnancy have an increased risk of recurrent reason throughout the first 3 years of 2 years of life, as we see here, compared to mothers not smoking during pregnancy. Smoking during pregnancy can result in both structural and functional changes in the airways. The airways have thicker walls in order with the human. They have increased airway resistance, abnormal pulmonary function in the first 1 year and a half, abnormal alveolar development, and they have also abnormal control of distribution, and the magnitude of the change is greater when the child is exposed during infancy than later on in childhood. And very importantly, I would like to stress that harmful effects are produced when exposed prenatally and postnatally. However, it has been found that systemic levels of harmful elements of tobacco are as high in the fetus as in the active smoke. Levels in the fetus as high as in the smoking mother, in the order of magnitude of higher than in passive smoke exposure via inhalation. And here again, this is the airways of a child who was exposed during pregnancy. The attachment of the interalveolar sac and the outer adventitia of the small airways, which is very important to keep the airways open during normal expiration, especially during expiration, the full region of the airways, they are deficient in number and are abnormally positioned. So they can get easily airway collapse during expiration. What about air pollution? Studying the effect of air pollution is very difficult because we have a lot of constituents that can cause air pollution. And studying each alone is a problem. However, it has been found that pregnant mothers living in chronically polluted areas have early fetal loss, preterm delivery, low birth weight, a child with increased in airway resistance, and this is probably has to do with depletion of exhaustion of the antioxidant system causing extracellular and intracellular in the airways. This study has been done in our unit and has been presented in the European Respiratory Society meeting 3 years ago. We studied the activity of glutathione peroxidase and superoxide dismutase in very early doses, and we found, as we see, in patients the level is extremely reduced. Although there is some overlap, but there is decreased level in patients compared to controls. The mechanism of antioxidant deficiency is either a primary enzyme deficiency, decreased activity because reflecting an overwhelmed antioxidant system, or decreased capacity of the child to rebuild and to reform the exhausted antioxidant activity, or a combination. What about the mechanical factors related to the development of the lungs and airways? And this is related to the uterine environment and the chest of the child. Fetal breathing movements are very important to the normal development of the airways. Through the stretch of these airways, a big breathing can result from chest wall anomalies, thoracic dysfunction, phrenic nerve agenesis, or anencephaly. They can be decreased by hypoxia or nicotine, again, the smoking mother. And experimental studies in animals have shown the same, that decreased breathing of fetal
art and peace and movement is associated with the fact of Erdogan. Another important point, Jurassic Space and Sheldon was conjointed by pragmatic hardware. The airway pressure is incomplete in both lungs, and there is undermatch in the structure of the airways with increased thickness. The post-water repair, and there is increased by increased alveolar space, however, there is too few airway in the alveoli because of the decreased space available at the beginning of developing in the airways. And another important part is the amniocentesis and its possible effect on lung growth. There is significant effect of amniocentesis as shown in this old study, so we have to be careful in the neonatal unit. What about the delivery of preterm children? This issue is very closely related to pregnancy. It has been discussed very nicely by Dr. Sonia Moss. Approximately 8% of all births occur before 37 weeks of gestation. I will not go to into details. I will just move quickly. There is structural and functional protection, as Dr. Sonia has mentioned. And this is related to the possibility of underlying cause of prematurity. Accelerated maturation, as if the child is trying to catch the first few months of weeks following delivery with altered underlying and postnatal airway development. And the resuscitation process itself, or the sheer force of airway going into the immature airways, can also result in the changes we will see and iatrogenic damage from resuscitation. So we have increasing rate immature infants that are surviving, but the prevalence of pulmonary sequelae are increasing as well. Now this is the pulmonary function of this experimental flu at 50, when 50% of the resuscitation rate of the test is expired. You see this dark box representing the values of preterm, more or less, as we say, healthy preterm. Here, the healthy preterms have lower pulmonary function, and this study has been done on children that were born prematurely, and they were recruited at the age between 14 and 21, and metoclopramide like responsiveness was tested, and as we see, this is the controls. These are the children that did not develop bronchopulmonary dysplasia, and those who developed bronchopulmonary dysplasia have the highest airway responsiveness. And therefore, many of them present very early in the nerve and in a picture similar to bronchitis. Structurally, both the airways and the alveoli are affected. And here there is collagen deposition in the interstitial alveoli. And in this child, this is a child taking as needed oxygen. This is a preterm child who is taking 100% oxygen. And here when oxygen, 100, is given by inhalation, this is a new preparation used experimentally in animals as a local antioxidant. You see there is much improvement compared with this, but still, of course, it is not normal. So this has its therapeutic application as well. What about the influence of birth weight or anti-uterine growth retardation? These children, nutrition of the mother is very important, and the quality of nutrition, whether it's more or related to different trace elements or vitamins, we see that maternal malnutrition will result in anti-uterine growth retardation and small for gestational age. They are small for gestational age, the lungs are small for gestational age, but are related to the body weight. We have as well reduced lung function, especially in the first year of life. A very important point is, most recently, vitamin A has been very well appreciated as regards its role in the elastic formation of the lungs and membranes. In an experimental animal, efficiency of elastin has been shown to be associated with effective lung development. Here, the children with small for gestational age, this was a dark triangle, those with a small for gestational age, and those with an open triangle of circuits at the normal or appropriate gestational age. And you see the dark circuit and the dark triangle at the lower level at the first visit and even during the period. So there is tracking of lung function. They continue to stay at the lower level. Here, this is an experimental, animal experiment in a mouse, which is related to the retinoic acid receptor, so he cannot take the photograph, commitment to an egg, which says it is effective and human formation and abnormal tendency. Infection has an important role both prenatally and early postnatally. This is an experimental study in animals when large polysaccharides of antitoxins added to the media will lead to this huge inflammatory infiltration and changes in the role of antibody. Early postnatal infections are very important, particularly viral infection, and this is a study on the murine web model of the spirometric situ virus in the acute stage and in the chronic stage 10 weeks after the entrance of the virus. We see that changes in the airways, there is inflammatory cells infiltrating the airways, there is collagen deposition, aura and lead, and after adding to the media a monoclonal antibody against the spirometric situ virus, it's another option for treatment. We see there is decrease in the inflammatory oxidant and collagen deposition. So this study can help for the future to plan for innovative therapies. And this is a para-influenza virus, again in an animal study, showing after 4 weeks of inoculation of the virus, there is inflammation and fibrosis in the airways. A very important point is that programming will not affect the structure only. It affects other systems, including the immune system as well. So, as we see here in the fetal gut, it's 16-week gestation, the virus patches contain IgA, a contain cells that can produce specific IgA. So, sensitization can occur in utero very early. And if the child has these both elements, in the normal airway and early sensitization, they have all the requirements to be a pacemaker child later on. So, we come back to this poor child. What is the value of all that we are discussing to this child? This, if we recognize this fact is very early in life during pregnancy, then we may can prevent early life losing or reduce early life losing, especially that many of these factors are preventable. It's enough to mention to this. Early recognition of high risk infants and therapeutic application, as we have seen, both maybe prenatally and postnatally. The most important is, as we see in this slide, the admission rate in children 3 to 4 years of age is increasing remarkably. In all other age groups, the admission rate is increasing. The admission rate is increasing in hospital remarkably in these age groups because they are underdiagnosed and underdiagnosed. And most of the mortalities we see in this age group, because of delay in the diagnosis of either bronchial asthma or viral induced. These children should not be left without treatment to outgrow the symptoms. They should be treated, guided by different international guidelines. And the most recent National Asthma Education and Prevention Program, XP3, that has been released in August this year, said that we can start control of therapy and with the children if they require symptomatic treatment more than 2 times a week. If they have viral induced raising more than every 6 weeks, that requires a year bronchodilators more than every 6 hours and more than 1 day. If they have more than 3 raising episodes, and 4 or more raising episodes in the past year, that lasted more than 1 day and affected skin and sleep, and have high risk factors of the asthma, both the combination, eczema, allergic sensitization, food allergy, two attacks within 6 months require systemic steroids. And if they have a severe or life threatening exacerbation. Now to conclude, knowledge of the interactions between the developing lung, genetic and environmental factors is essential as progress is to be made in early diagnosis and the development of new interventions aimed at reducing the long term morbidity from chronic lung diseases. And early intervention is very important to ensure normal growth and development of the lung and airways, and we should follow international guidelines. This is very important. Prospective studies are needed to evaluate the possible long-term outcome of different environmental insults in lung growth and development. Thank you.
is energy efficient. This allows us to get the time to and figures and patient size and improve price at the time price. The case also is faster than the other one. Strategy
one, on children developing pancreatitis and for several years after, and your time and patients have been given to see if they can change the natural use. But this child will stop developing later on recurrent cancer. However, as long as the child is under treatment, there is decrease in the symptoms and decrease in the frequency of varying. And reason, however, once you stop, the child continues in his pattern and there is recurrence of the lesion. Except, of course, there is spontaneous recurrence. Some of the patients don't grow the symptoms when they are 3 to 4 years of age of the diagnostic lesion. However, it will not change the natural history of the disease. As long as you give the medication and the same applies to the AI for different studies. Yes, the studies have shown that they do not change the natural history. As long as you are giving the medication, you are controlling the symptoms of the disease. Once you stop, the process continues. Right? Unless the child goes into a spontaneous remission, then this is not the future. While some children go into a spontaneous remission, and this is not.
This is very, very new, and it's very, very good what has been mentioned. But there's so much program in the state of life, so that when we're really out to the world, we have little to do. We also take a very tender point, which is the air pollution. And I know this is the problem that we're dealing with, especially at this time of the season, a little bit earlier than this, and everybody knows about that. The question that has been asked by the mother you exposed, she said, shall I take out the baby to the air, or should I keep him inside and lock the doors? What do you think is the right answer?
But first, I want to thank the organizing committee for giving me the chance to be here today. And I hope that you're going to find this a nice concluding and nice closure for this very fruitful session. And the topic is going to be tuberculosis in children as a novel insight. And in short, we're going to discuss new approaches regarding tuberculosis in children as the best evidence available to you. And of course, if we are going to talk about what's novel, we must not ever forget what's life. And I will begin and start in Egypt, and documented by the Egyptian mummies about 5,000 years ago. And this photo shows the Gibbous, and it is adapted from the tuberculosis textbook. It's just published and released this year, and the good news, it's available with me electronically, and I'm very happy to send that for free for anybody who's in my home. By the basics, never to forget that natural history of tuberculosis in children passes through three stages, and we can define it either in a stage of exposure or infection or disease. As diagnosed by new signs and new symptoms in just the contact or exposure, and typically skin test is negative in this stage, but just we have the history, and the second is the infection, and sometimes we call it latent infection or
Those people who have no signs and symptoms and no steps to the venous temples and no state of disease, who have three of this, either signs and symptoms or the graphic abnormal seizures that was tuberculosis, evidence of TB, microbiology, and or TSD or tuberculosis skin test. This figure was adapted from a very recent review released in 2007 in Breed Journal, and it is done by Dr. James Patton of East Breed. He is the director of the Pediatric Assembly of PDS, British Pediatric Society. And as you see, this was a survey done in England and Wales showing that the most common sites of tuberculosis, followed by lymphadenopathy, blood flow, tuberculosis lymphadenopathy, second, intrathoracic lymphadenopathy, and followed by the CNS and children. Never forget the old and the new also, the methogenesis of tuberculosis, and here, as we have considered that the pulmonary tuberculosis is the commonest form, that the introduction is going to be through the alveoli of the acid source bacilli, and according to the presence of the alveolar macrophages, it's going to turn into no infection or infection, and infection will attract more cells to do granuloma, and the fate of the granuloma is going to depend upon the ability of the person or the child either to turn into latent tuberculosis or active tuberculosis, and this is guided also by many risk factors here, and the older latent tuberculosis turn to active, or if he has another active exogenous exposure. And we never forget that the natural history of the past pelvis, which is called postpartum tuberculosis, it's the adult form. We never see it except after 7 years from the infection, cavitation and smear positive sputum, which is little bit rare in our childhood. In tuberculosis, we have this, truly, a lot of theories in the past, and many, many little proofs. So, let's see what I do. TB, or not TB, that's the question. Actually, I have adapted that from Shakespeare, but actually, we need it. WHO has developed and adapted a new big strategy called WHO Stop TB Strategy, and this was done in Geneva in 2006, and it is a big program done by the WHO, planning to stop tuberculosis from the whole world by the year of 2050. What is all about children, that a lot of guidelines has changed, a lot of approaches has changed, and guidelines, especially for TB in children, with special consideration including HIV and TB drug resistance, has been more enlightened, and what's called National TB Program, or NTB, and if you're going to follow the literature, newly released, you're going to find this more broad because it's following the WHO guidelines. Let's start. First step to diagnose tuberculosis in children, which is a big clue and a big problem. Tuberculosis in children was always supposed to be a neglected theory and neglected condition. According to the WHO recommendations released in 2006, we have these statistics. First, careful history, including the TB scores, clinical examination, food and birth assessment, tuberculin skin test, bacteriological confirmation. If it is possible, it's a small warning children that tuberculosis is associated with severe disease, and we have investigation relevant for pulmonary or extrapulmonary tuberculosis according to the site of the disease, and according to the WHO guidelines, if we have any of the three clues for tuberculosis, we're going to diagnose active disease. And lastly, what was adopted recently, that in every tuberculosis child, never to forget to assist for HIV if you are in a prevalent country for HIV. And by the way, it's found in Egypt. And recently I have diagnosed it in the family of my patient, which they are very strict and they're very behaving. So it's bad. Starting by the cluster history, contact history is very important. Chronic symptoms like chronic cough, chronic fever, failure to thrive, this is the old issues we have discussed and we are still need for it in children. And what was old and new as well is presence of many clinical TB scores, and they are very valuable for our diagnosis in children. Second is the clinical examination. Never to forget growth retardation, which is one of the very earliest clues for tuberculosis. The pulmonary and extrapulmonary or organ infection symptoms are going to appear according to the site of infection. Third, we have tuberculin skin test, all new as well. But what was new is the standardized
doses and tests done by the WHO, that it is either 5 to the clean units of BBD or PR514 negative S, or 2 units of PR514 negative RT26. This is very important. We must talk the same language everywhere. The problems with skin testing is false negative, which is prevalent. If the child is immunodeficient, wired for any reason, either temporary or permanent, this is going to be not a good test for assessment, especially if you are considering HIV. And false positive, we have very prevalent environmental other non-tuberculous bacteria, and PCG immunization could sometimes mask or give a false positive. However, this is going to be discussed very recently with a very interesting issue. Bacteriological confirmation, if it is possible, actually I always must say that, because the first problem to get the sample, and sometimes it's a little bit difficult on children. And if we got it, we cannot ever forget that the children are almost, almost pussy for similar. That's to say, it's hard to find the organism. The samples could be sputum, could be gastric leverage, could be induced sputum, which is discussed recently a lot. Given a lot of promising results, however, it's very, very dangerous, and a lot of precautions on the body of child, by the way to do it, is restore two restaurants, preferring antibiotic biopsies, chloroform biopsies, CSF, acetic fab, joint fab, bicarbonate fab, and here is the according to the symptoms suggesting of the disease organ or infected organ by tuberculosis. Microscopic smear is going to remain one of the standard, easy and expensive first. The origin of the standard was to be done by Zim Nelson. We have to forget that new stains could be taken, if we consider. And sputum induction, as we have said, using nidodose of 3% saline. And by the way, this could be done in infants, not only in children, able to do the sputum reduction. And this is the difference, because this high concentration of saline is going to produce an attack of cough. So, a lot of precautions by the body actually to do it. However, it's promising to get more Boston samples, but it must be in a closed room, it must be not exposed to other person because everybody attending, it could be infected. Conventional cultures, including a lot of Australian Nielsen, a very interesting capitalist media, and up to 3 weeks we need a minimum to show a burst of growth. Yield of extrapulmonary sites is very, very low, more than pulmonary samples. And what is more recent than the conventional media is the liquid media, and almost all the pediatric pulmonologists are aware of it, but this is the second media. Also, it has its automated apparatus to assess, and in the book of tuberculosis, it's a big textbook. This is discussed nervously with pictures and with the most recent steps to do. What was important and curious about this type of media or automated media that our first time about 1 to 2 weeks versus a higher recovery rates than solid media, and you can see here one of the conclusions or summaries about comparison between Bactic and other automated media and conventional. Almost the Bactic media or automated liquid media needs half the duration to assess for pressure. And then we reach the fifth step, investigation relevant for suspected TB, starting by flexible bronchoscopy. If you are going to suspect pulmonary tuberculosis, could flexible bronchoscopy be useful? Actually, it's a fuse in indolent bronchial disease assessment and diagnosis. It does urinary obstruction to release and for sample collection. However, the research revealed that the bronchial alveolar device is not a very useful tool for assessment of bacteriological PCR, and it is important for biochemical markers much more, and we have done a very beautiful work in our unit in Angeles University with Professor Victor Price, where we have shown marvelous markers to assess biochemical markers for tuberculosis. However, the resolution of CBSMR is not very common, but one of the papers that was published that drug gastric leverage could be much better than bronchoscopic. Nucleic acid amplification, or PCR, we must not forget that sensitivity in children could be 40% for the same reason that our pussy is alive, as 50-80% false positive with non-tuberculous bacteria, lower sensitivity, and extrapulmonary, with extrapulmonary samples, that is documented. These molecular probes are the chest X-ray, it shows early sensitivity in 60% of adults and less sensitivity in children and lower sensitivity in HIV-suspected droplet patients. See the scan importance is to find higher methodology and to observe the variability with famous assessment in my full field of data dealing to the multiple with the famous expected to do the CT. High resolution and spiral CT are much higher. Magnetic resonance imaging and better regarding assessment of fibrosis versus inflammation and especially of importance in extracellular disease. And now let's talk about what's new evidence of tuberculosis, which is called new test or promising test, and we must stop for a while to remind ourselves about the pathology. Once a typical SMI is introduced in the body, an antigen presenting cell is going to present it to the memory T cell, and memory T cell is going to be distributed everywhere in the body, including the skin. Once we're introducing the BVD or purified protein derivative, so we're going to do a duration of erythema of tuberculosis skin test. But the cell area is found also in blood, so the memory T cell is found also in blood. On activation, reactivation again by tuberculosis SMI, gamma interferon fibrin. So if we're going to be released, we're interleukin 8 and tumor necrosis factor in the tumors. So this was the base for what's called T-cell based gamma interferon assay. And it is not just an interferon assay, gamma interferon assay assessment. It is more than that. It is a gamma interferon produced when the memory T-cell is confronted with tuberculin SMI. So we can use any of the antigen of the tuberculin SMI, either for field protein derivative, the old one, or what's called early secretory epidemic target, ESA6, or culture filter protein CEP10, and this could be assessed by what's called either ELISA-based or T-spot T-test. This is the summary of the test. It's very promising. All the literature nowadays are talking about this test, and that's why we're going to read it everywhere. Only is to take a blood sample from the child, open overnight after blood sample, and to incubate it with one of the methods of feeding tuberculosis antigen that we have just taught, and incubate either overnight or sometimes better for 5 to 6 days, and then the first phase of this cell, supposed if the house is frozen, they're going to release a lot of interferon gamma. This is going to be assessed either by ELISA system, and this is going to see as concentration of interferon gamma or by what's called T-spot T-test, TB test, and this is assessed computerized by the computer. What's new? That this test has been used recently in diagnosis of TB and distinguishing mycobacterium tuberculosis from non-tuberculous mycobacteria. It can differentiate tuberculosis from BCG very efficiently, and it's very, very important data on infection of tuberculosis and for monitoring treatment. And recently, just this month, at ERS, Google has been released a paper which says assessed that in tumor effusion samples that it was very successful to diagnose tuberculosis. One of the most issues is just a critical issue, TB in HIV-infected children. As we said, HIV assessment must be done at every tuberculosis child in a prevalent place and in Egypt we have HIV. TB diagnosis differs only at tuberculosis skin test with the time tuberculosis with lesser in duration, more or equal to 5 millimeter, and treatment considered longer duration but the same measurement. And what was new, as recommended by WHO, that cotrimoxazole for HIV children gives a very good prophylaxis against tuberculosis and pulmonary infection. Interaction between antiretroviral or ART and rifampicin has well documented, as rifampicin is a new microsomal enzyme inhibitor. And what's called immune reconstitution inflammatory syndrome, this is a syndrome which is described by the WHO, once you concomitant antitubercles with antiviral, antiretroviral therapy, and to see more details, you can find the WHO line. Lastly, we reach this algorithm, whether it is infection, yes or no, disease, yes or no, risk of contact. Once, when to treat the exposure, if they are less than 3 years or immunocompromised, disease patient can be classified according to smear positive or smear negative through the regimen of the treatment. And now, we cannot stop except we ask ourselves the future of BCG vaccine. Which strain and which strain? What's well known that the Salicylic green strain, which is developed about a century ago, is still used up till now by different manufacturers, from
Jersey, where the country had produced from, Copenhagen, Durban, Tokyo, and so on. However, local had available here in Egypt produced by Copenhagen scale for 10 years after now. And we have a very nice work. It's about to be published in our work in our department. If you're watching this from Norway, it's program at Aarhus University, and we have just finally surveyed about 600 children for our PCG vaccination, and we found that the school has found that about 90% of the children have taken the PCG vaccine as of the success of the problem with the compulsory vaccination, that 60% have the score, and what was very alarming to us, that only 3% show activity in conversion. This is a big question. Is the BCG available valid or not? And this is also a place for further and future more immunogenic and more protective vaccines. So the first step, if we are going to follow the international TB stop strategy, is to do better prevention in children. And the second step, of course, is to do better diagnosis, optimal sample, optimal procedure for the lab, better imaging, and rule-based guidelines and diagnostics must be more available. But we have the third step, which is very important, better treatment of tuberculosis in children. We must never forget the criteria of that drug-resistant tuberculosis in children. If children diagnose the source case, if it is resistant, how can it diagnose a tuberculosis child if it is having the only or pretty resistant TB drug? And this is the book. I'm very happy to send it for anybody who sent me an email. It's a full text. It's about 700 pages, full of pictures, very interesting and very recent. It's called Tuberculosis from Basic Science to Patient Care. And this guidelines include guidance for National Tuberculosis Program and the management of tuberculosis in children. It's one of the most released by the WHO. It's free on the net. And also, I'm very willing to send it for anybody who cannot find it on the net, however, it's available for free. And thank you. We have actually very little time for the discussion. And so I'm going to have one question.
With the very chicken. After you can feel it, the fissure exists in the sedation. After the weeks of hydrosis for the short period, the weeks are in the period of examination for the
chicken. Thank you. Apparently invited to attend is a symposium on Wednesday, 5th December, that's today. Carla Merrick, and I have a room, 7 to 9 p.m. The chairperson of the Professor Dr. Philip Sutton. The panel will be Professor Dr. Adolf Fittor, Professor Dr. Richard Hatton, Professor Dr. Hassan Buda, Professor Dr. Tara Akhuz. The content will be the current approaches and future trends in asthma by Professor Dr. Tara Akhuz. It's going to be for 25 minutes. Panel discussion for 35 minutes and case studies moderated by Professor Dr. Richard Hatton. The whole panel will take around 1 hour.